Hi there, Coach Sage of SageRunning.com here with another training talk. Today we're going to talk about marathon training. And I've done a lot of other talks on this. You can check out the playlist. I'll link to some of them at the end of this. How to run a sub 3 hour marathon, how to get faster, any service, any distance. And a lot of it always revolves around the first tip, building an aerobic base or getting your weekly mileage or weekly volume up. So we see a lot of improvements with athletes that's maybe you've just started running. You've been running for a couple of years. You're running 30 or 40 miles a week, 50K, 60K type a week, and you're eventually able to safely not get injured, but build your easy pace mileage up, mainly easy pace mileage, about 80% of it, usually, up into the 50 or 60 mile week range, or 80 to 100 kilometers per week. We see a lot of improvements there, and it's something that is manageable to do, but it depends on a lot of variables. Variables, not only your actual age, but your training age, or how long you've been running, what your background is in the sport, whether you've just started out or you've been doing consistent mileage like that over the years. It's easier to jump up slowly without getting injured or hurt. But other factors like nutrition, your diet, your lifestyle, life stresses. A lot of us have work obligations, family obligations, so you only have a certain amount of time and energy to devote your day to training, but also just running more frequently throughout the week, whether it's increasing from running 4 days a week, training 4 days a week, to running 5 or 6 days a week. That's usually where people see a lot of benefits, to even sometimes running 7 days a week or twice a day. Usually the doubles, running twice a day, doesn't really kick in until you have to get over 70 miles per week or running pretty high volume. So don't worry about that if you're below that. But let's break it down. Marathon training, building the aerobic base, always key, consistent high mileage over time, and staying healthy. And a lot of that is running slow and easy. So I'll throw out some pace ranges as well as some key workouts that I've found have helped me throughout my marathon career. And I do still do road marathons. I also do ultra marathons. But I was able to run my best marathon of my career at Boston 2 years ago, getting 16th place, 2:19 at Boston. It was poor weather. It wasn't my fastest time, but I consider that breakthrough my best marathon performance of my career. I've also run 2:16 on the marathon, 2:16:52 as a PR. And lessons I learned from that is that training more is not always better. I ran a lot higher mileage, 130, 140 miles a week for years, running professionally after college on the roads. And sometimes I overtrained, I overdid it, and I came out tired, and I ran a lot slower than 220. Whereas I was able to run several minutes faster on actual less mileage, more targeted workouts, and not overdoing myself or overextending myself on the intense workouts, so to speak. And the intense workouts that you need for marathon training really come down into a couple parts. And the first key after building your aerobic base, consistent mileage, having high mileage over periods of time, long periods of time, months and months going into your marathon to give you the strength and endurance you need, is you need variations in your long run types of workouts. A lot of people just see a mileage number and they're just like, oh yeah, it's an 18 mile long run this weekend. I gotta do 18 miles. And they just think of it in terms of just getting in the miles. And you do wanna get in the miles, but it's all relative to certain intensities. So in a lot of our workouts on our Boston qualifying marathon plan, our Sage Running BQ plan on our website, sagerunning.com, link in the description below, you'll see variations on long runs, long run workouts where you actually hit your marathon goal race pace, or you practice running even faster than marathon goal race pace for little segments at a time in the second half of a long run. And most of the long runs also by nature, you want to be able to speed up when you're tired going into a long run. And because you're running high mileage, you go into these long runs on the weekends usually with tired legs. You're not totally tapered, you're not rested up, you're low on glycogen, even if you eat a high carb diet. So you get into those adaptations of fat burning and being able to practice your hydration strategy, nutrition strategy during the run. That being said, you know, like I said before, there's a lot of variables at play with genetics, how well you respond to training, but also how injury prone you might be, or you know, how much mileage you could handle. And you want to have these adaptations, which are tried and true for most people, to really kick in. And so long runs, very specific type of workout, quality workout for a marathon, very demanding workout. So some of the long runs are very hard and demanding, and you're speeding up and you're doing 3 minute surges at 10K pace or something like that, or you're running 8 miles at the end, or 12 kilometers at the end, at a very steady pace that's very close to your marathon race pace, to get that the legs used to what it's like to run hard when they're tired, basically, and to run that velocity. Then you can talk about velocity and quality in marathon training. You know, I always preach building an aerobic base, an easy pace, conversational pace where you're really relaxed, and that's great for getting mileage in. That's great for about 80% of your mileage. I talk about this in my running book, The Sage Running Secret, 80-20 split, usually, and a general average, and that's been preached by coaches for decades. It's nothing new, is that, you know, you're doing all these recovery runs, easy pace runs, but you need to get in some quality if you want to reach your potential in the marathon, and you need to have a good nutrition and hydration strategy for during the race as well, to optimize performance and optimize speed. And so with that, the intensity comes in, it comes sprinkled in small amounts. And what I found running professionally after college for an Olympic development group, as well as my own training, running track Division I in college, 10K on the track, is that you do need to do some interval types of workouts and some faster types of workouts that are a higher velocity than your goal marathon pace. And a lot of you probably come from running 5Ks and 10Ks and half marathons before you actually step up to the marathon distance. So that's always good preparation and a good rotation in your year of training and racing to have that faster running mix. So you apply that speed, that movement, that efficiency or running economy to your marathon pace. So we still do workouts around 10K pace and 5K pace, but those are going to be used very sparingly. So maybe they start off as 800 meter repeats. Maybe they go up to kilometer repeats. And let's say your goal is to try to crack 3 hours in the marathon or run, it's about 6:52 per mile pace. Well, you need to be doing some workouts closer to 6 minute mile pace or at least some sort of threshold workouts that are well under 4 minutes per kilometer type of pace. So significantly faster than your half marathon pace even, maybe closer to 10K pace. And you're doing workouts like 8x1,000 meters or even 4 or 5 times 1,600 meters or 4 or 5 times a mile. And you're doing those close to maybe 6:20 per mile pace or something like that. And you know, those are used more as a mechanical efficiency type of thing. It gets your heart and lungs up really well. It touches on VO2 max or aerobic capacity, so we talk about. But it makes it so marathon pace feels a lot easier, and you're not huffing and puffing too much if you go up a hill or, you start out too fast. You have this ease of movement. You're more relaxed. You're more economical and efficient because you've done some high-intensity intervals. But you don't need very many of those, right? And that's usually more in the last 8 weeks or so going into your marathon race. But you also might do some early in a training cycle, and you'll see this on our sagerunning.com training plans. Early in a cycle, much like Jack Daniel's rep phase, so to speak, where we start off with some shorter interval types of workouts to build that efficiency. Helps your running form, helps your breathing, gets you trained to be more efficient on the aerobic level, high-end aerobic work, with not too much lactic acid built in. You're not breaking down so much, but they are demanding workouts, and they get more demanding when you do longer intervals. The other key, the final key types of workouts that I've always preached, 20-minute tempo run, lactic threshold training, kind of the same thing, up-tempo runs, we call them, a lot of the long workouts on our sagerunning.com training plans, is doing the steady state, so to speak, steady state type of intensity that is very slightly faster than marathon pace to closer to your 10K race pace. And if you don't know that exactly, you might race a 10K or do a hard workout in this 85 maximum heart rate, 85% of your maximum heart rate, 8 out of 10 type of effort scale, for 20 or 30 minutes on a run. And so you're doing a lot of these workouts that just so happen to be 15, 20 seconds per mile faster than your marathon race pace, or what is that, like 10, 12 seconds per kilometer faster than marathon race pace. So 3 hour marathon example, 6:52 mile pace. Maybe you're doing a lot of workouts at 6:35 per mile tempo run. 4 mile run at 6:30 mile pace, or even 2 times 5K at 6:35 per mile pace with a short rest in between, working on that lactate threshold. But it's very helpful to be efficient at running slightly faster than your marathon race pace, because again, it makes marathon race pace feel a lot slower. And these workouts are also used sparingly, but this is the type of training that could be used almost year round, and it's always good for developing aerobic base because it's a very aerobic stimulus in nature. It gets demanding mainly because of the duration and the distance. So, 20-minute tempo run, 30-minute, 40-minute up-tempo run. Maybe you're doing these at the end of a long run. Maybe you're doing 5K intervals, 2x5K, even 3x5K sometimes we have, or 2 mile repeats, 3K repeats with a short rest. And yeah, so that, that's around, I guess, metric 4:03, 4:04 per kilometer pace, 6:32 mile pace about threshold would be for this theoretical 3 hour flat marathon runner. And that's if you were in 3:83 flat shape though. Currently, maybe you're working for a 3:30 or something like that. And time range does matter. Time range matters. And that'll be my final point on this long training talk, is that if you're closer to 4 hours in the marathon, the training spectrum, the pace intensity spectrum, changes a little bit, because that means usually your tempo run pace is a lot faster than your marathon race pace. Maybe instead of being 10 or 15 seconds per mile difference, it's 20 or 30 seconds per mile difference. And part of that's just the nature of the velocity that you're running at, the duration that you have to race for. Part of it could be your experience level, what your weekly mileage is, how long you've been running. Because as you get more in shape, as you get more fit, and as you get faster, let's say you start running 2:40 in the marathon, well, your threshold's a lot closer to your marathon pace. So the spectrum changes depending on your finishing time and your goal time. And a final note on that, within these intensities, is that the other thing that really determines marathon success is your execution on race day in terms of pacing. Pacing yourself conservatively in the first 10K, relaxing, working into it, warming up into it, and then being able to run a steady pace in the last 10K. That's the biggest thing I've found in my best marathon races, is it's a matter of just not falling apart in the last 10K. You don't have to, if you are able to speed up a ton in the last 10K, that's great. You probably paced yourself too conservatively, but most people crash and burn in the last 10K. And it's really about getting to the 20 mile mark or the 32 kilometer mark and being able to maintain for the last 10K. Even if you slow down 10 seconds per mile, 15 seconds per mile, or 10 seconds per kilometer, a little slower than your average pace, you're still probably going to run a pretty good marathon. It's when you crash and burn and you start running 30 seconds, 40 seconds per mile slower than your average pace, or 20 seconds per kilometer slower than your average pace, all in the last 10Ks, where you lose all that time. And part of it comes down to pace strategy, running at a manageable pace. Trying to run a fairly even pace with even half splits is always good. And if you've raced a half, you could kind of benchmark off of that, right? You're not going to crack 3 hours in the marathon if you've peaked for a half and have a lot of experience in a half and you haven't run under 128, it's going to be really hard to run two 130s back to back. People might have done it, but they probably hadn't maximized the potential in the half. Usually you need to be knocking on at least a 125, 126 half to be looking to run a sub 3 hour marathon, to run two 130s back to back. That's just the 3 hour example. You might be in the 330 range and looking at 145 half splits or something like that. So it's a big thing. Generally taking in carbs, I use my Spring Energies, my gel type of sponsor. Getting in carbs every 8K or every 5 miles for a lot of people could be in the liquid form. Depends on weather and things like that, but that's kind of a good strategy. A lot of people be like, I'm all fat burning. I just burn fat. I'm I don't need to take any calories in during my marathon race. Well, I'd say to that is, yeah, I could go out and run 26 miles without taking anything out, probably without drinking anything. It's not too hot, but I'm not going to run my fastest. I could definitely run faster if I'm drinking in some fluid and taking in some carbs, because otherwise I'm going to be hitting up against that wall. And it's a fine line because you don't want to have stomach distress, but if you are taking in some carbs and staying hydrated and drinking and eating regularly throughout your marathon, you're less likely to have that big bonk. You could curve up against the wall. And if you try to go fat burning, you might not hit the wall, but you probably didn't run to your potential, right? You could run faster if you're pushing the envelope. And it's a fine balance. It's a tough line. I've crashed and burned in over half my marathons, and then some of them are just mediocre, some of them go pretty well, but that's kind of what I've learned over the years. I do want to try to go back and qualify for the Olympic trials in 2020. Window opens up at the end of this year, so still looking for that sub 219. But yeah, thanks so much for subscribing on your guys. Thanks again. Check out the playlist. A link to some of my other marathon training talks at the end here, as well as hit that subscribe button, thumbs up. If you like these types of videos, really appreciate all the support and comments and the Patreon supporters. Thanks so much. Again, you can check out our training plans at sagerunning.com. See you next time.